We're moving now from Dutch Guiana over to French Guiana. And I want to give you a little bit of background on French Guiana. French Guiana started out before the United States was even a country. France sent about 12,000 settlers there. 10,000 of them died immediately, tropical diseases, heat, that sort of thing. And the 2,000 that were left decided that it was not safe to be on the mainland. And so they found some islands just offshore. And they moved to those islands because the mosquitoes weren't as bad. The environment was much more sanitary. These islands they called the Salvation Islands. And one of these islands we're going to be talking about later is called Devil's Island. Remember that name. We are coming back to it. One interesting fact is that French Guiana is actually a part of France. So that when you go into French Guiana, you are effectively going into France. It's as much a part of France as Alaska or Hawaii are part of the United States. It's an integral part of the country. At one time, Dutch Guiana was also a part, an integral part, of the Netherlands until it declared independence. In any event, going into French Guiana is going into France, and the customs and immigration laws and the currency is all going to be exactly the same as it is in France. Now, when the French sold Louisiana to the United States, they had a problem. They needed some place to send their worst convicts to. They had been sending them to Louisiana, like the British eventually are sending them to Australia. And so they started looking around for a place to put those convicts, and they decided on French Guiana. Over a period of time, they sent some 50,000 or a little bit more convicts to French Guiana. Now, you remember what I told you about the settlers dying? Well, the convicts were dying at about the same rate.
The butterfly. You're Pepe, aren't you?
Yeah.
The bastards gave you life.
Right to the end of the line, I think.
It may not be as long as you think. 40% of us will die the first year out. But a man like you could make it. If you have enough money.
How long were you there?
9 years. Work camp. 9 years a colonist.
You were outside the walls. Why didn't you run? There's no place to run to. You're out in the middle of a swamp, 1,000 miles from no place. Well, if you got a lot of money, that's a different thing. I mean,
if you served out your sentence and survived in French Guiana, you were one of only 10% of the convicts that they sent there. 90% died of some kind of disease while they were incarcerated. And at one point, for a fairly long period of time, France said, well, wait, even if you serve your time out in Guiana, we don't want you to come back to France. Instead, what we want is we want you to stay in Guiana for a period of time at least as long as your original sentence was. The result was that as a practical matter, once a French convict was sent to the Guianas, he never came back to France.
Now, in order to keep the colony growing, the new colonists needed to have wives. And so France arranged to have girls that were undesirables, mostly prostitutes, sent to French Guiana. with the intent that they would marry these colonists. However, in fact, many of them continued their original profession. Saint Laurent was also the location for the reception center for new convicts coming into France, so that all of them would be processed through this port. The first stop is the transportation camp, and the next thing that happens, after a little while at least, is you're given a pep talk about what your behavior is expected to be like.
Welcome to the penal colony of French Guiana, whose prisoners you are, and from which there is no escape. First attempts at escape add 2 years in solitary to existing sentences. Second attempts add 5 more. Of course, more serious offenses are dealt with in this fashion. Make the best of what we offer you, and you will suffer less than you deserve. Dismissed.
Next, you might be introduced to your accommodations. They could be at the in the cells or in the blockhouse, either one.
I'm Jojo Papio. How do I look? I feel pretty good. I need somebody to tell me how I look.
Fine. You look fine.
In some ways, the cells were actually preferable to the general population's blockhouse, where you were stuffed in a room with a fairly large number of your closest personal friends. And this is the bar of justice. The bar of justice is what holds you in the bed. This is what it looks like. Your foot goes through that loop there. And the way that it does that is the bar is lifted up and the metal parts are taken out. After your leg chafed on this metal bar for a while, it must have been absolutely excruciating. And this is where the convicts would wash the guards' clothes. The convicts did virtually all the labor that there was done in the camp. In fact, for all practical purposes, they entirely built the camp themselves. Of course, the camp had its own disciplinary system, its own tribunals. This particular camp seems to have been under Navy control because there was a Navy court-martial office here. We are now at the cell of the most famous inmate of this particular prison. He usually goes by the name Papillon, which means the butterfly. It was his nickname. His real name is André Scherrer, and he made a book, and we'll be coming back to him. So don't forget Papillon. From here, prisoners might be sent to the interior to do additional construction work of one kind or another.
Men accustomed to city life in the temperate zone were put to work chopping down huge trees in the heart of the tropics. Half would quickly break and die. To the administration, the men are things to be disposed of. René Belbenoît.
So if things were this bad, why not run away? The walls and the guards would not be enough to prevent an escape.
Escape through the jungle? Almost an impossibility. The convicts become prey to it and perish. Escape by way of Dutch Guiana must have been hunted down and sent back to Saint Laurent. But there is the great and magnificent way of the sea. And this is the most dangerous of all. René Belbenoît.
We'll take to the water later, but for now, we're heading for the swamp.
À droite là-bas, 10 minutes, il y a le bourg de Caux. Donc ce petit bourg là contient.
This is the boat that's taking me out into the swamp, out to the boathouse, actually, and in the back there at the motor, you see my guide, Ricky. I was told that for the third year in a row, it's been unusually wet in the Guianas. I personally link that to the La Niña, which we've had for the past 3 years. This is the third year of the La Niña. In any case, the extra water was not something that I welcomed. It does improve your ability to get around by boat. The people that are with me are mostly French-speaking people, and this is my houseboat coming up where I've got a room. The houseboat isn't quite so much a boat as it is a floating pier, but it's got a dining room and bedrooms and water and a kitchen and all that sort of thing, so it'll do for the time being. From our boat, most of what we saw were birds, but not the sort of thing that you would expect would cause terror in the heart of a convicted escapee.
Bon, souvent, on croisera ces plantes-là à droite. Les tiges sont les moukou-moukou. This plant on the left, the sticks, moukou-moukou.
For the most part, the birds were pretty, but not exactly what I was looking for. I was looking mostly for reptiles and mammals.
Les petits qu'on a vus ce matin étaient tout noirs. Là, c'est les grands. Sont bleutés.
This swamp has lots of bromeliads in it. And the most obvious birds are the parrots and macaws. They're very colorful and very noisy. As you would expect, many of the birds depend on fishing for a living. Now we have an eye test coming up in the next picture. Can you spot the bird? It's a nightjar, and he's sleeping during the day so that he can work at night. Here's another angle in case you missed him. Seeing as though we can't find anything particularly dangerous that would intimidate an escaping convict in the swamps during the day, we're going to go out at night. And we'll be focusing on crocodilians. But first, we need to know what a crocodilian looks like and what kind you might find in this area as opposed to other areas and what the differences are. Now, I'm not going to be talking about all of the possible crocodilians in the world. We're going to focus our attention on three generic types. Crocodiles, alligators, and caimans. And of those two, it's the alligators and caimans that we'll focus on the most. First of all, alligators tend to have a snout that is more U-shaped. It's a broader snout. Crocodiles, on the other hand, tend to have a narrower snout and a more V-shaped snout, as you see here. Alligators and caiman are in the alligator family, tend to have teeth that are visible only from the top jaw, whereas crocodiles, you can see the teeth from both the top and the bottom jaw, making them look much more snaggly. Let's focus on the alligator family now. There are only two places in the world where you can find true alligators. You know one. It's the United States. The other one, curiously enough, is China, where they only have a couple of hundred of them, and they are smaller than the American alligator. They're also edible and therefore endangered. Caiman are in the alligator family, but they're not true alligators. I've never heard a really convincing explanation of what the difference is between them, but one thing that I'm pretty sure of is that true alligators, like the Chinese alligator and the American alligator, can survive freezing temperatures. I don't know of any crocodiles or any caiman that can survive freezing temperatures. But the kind of crocodilians that they have in South America, once you go below the area where there are actual crocodiles, are called caiman, and there are a fairly large number of them. The spectacled caiman, for example, is relatively small, and the smooth-fronted caiman is fairly small again. It can come up to about 8 feet. Crocodilians do tend to be dangerous once they get above 12 or 14 feet in length. That is dangerous to humans. So we're going out at night to look for some caiman. In order to find them, we're going to be looking mostly for eye shine. That is, you shine a light out into the darkness, and when you see a little light about the size of an eyeball or so out in the distance, you may very well have seen the eye of a caiman or a frog or something else. In any case, it allows you to know where something is that might be an interesting target. This caiman has submerged. Nevertheless, he looks like he's probably a spectacled caiman. Spectacled caiman only get to be about 8 feet or so, and therefore they're not usually considered to be extraordinarily dangerous to human beings. This is what he looks like out of water. Notice the bony eye ridges that are very pronounced. They look a little bit like he's wearing eyeglasses, and therefore he is spectacled. If a spectacled caiman or some other fairly small caiman might not terrify a fleeing felon, a black caiman may very well. It's roughly the same size as the American alligator. It could be even more fierce in some ways. Its armor is a little bit thicker and tougher, and its teeth are a little bit thinner, which would mean that if it were to bite an American alligator, it might do considerable damage. Now, the reality is, when you've got one kind of crocodilian facing off against another, the bigger one will almost always win. Crocodiles do have a slight advantage, assuming that they're of equal size to their opponent, because the alligator doesn't have the temperament, the aggressiveness, that a crocodile does. A caiman has a little bit more aggressiveness than an American alligator, but not nearly as much as a crocodile. So if the face-off is between an American alligator and a crocodile of the same size, bet on the crocodile. If it's between an American alligator and a black caiman of the same size, bet on the black caiman. This, I am told, is a black caiman. Notice that he's not entirely black. He is, however, submerged, and that does make it a little bit more difficult for you to see exactly what he looks like.
Ils mangent quand
Mais ils mangent là toute la journée, toute la nuit.
Ouais.
Ouais, ils ont. Là, il était en train de manger. Là. Là, le museau ouvert, et dès qu'il y a les petits poissons qui viennent murmurer dans son bec, ben, il n'y a pas.
Ah, il va pas à la chasse, il attend pour les poissons.